I was born in 1945, so perhaps that makes me an early baby boomer. Since childhood, I've always loved making art. I remember as a kid when my mother would have friends over, I'd be in the back building things, painting, and drawing, and I'd run out and show what I'd done, and she'd gush, "Oh, that's so wonderful." Her encouragement may have come in part because she was a pretty good artist herself. I probably inherited my painting skills from her. Since the 1980s, I've made my living as a painter. But I've also made money building and selling boat models. People often ask, how can you part with them? And I say, oh, I've already had my fun. I've always enjoyed making things. It's as simple as that. I like starting with a blank canvas, so to speak, and creating something new. Ships in the ocean have always fascinated me. I appreciate the beauty of boat design and craftsmanship, even in a simple skiff. I also love the stark beauty of the marshlands and the docks and warehouses of a working waterfront. Some people have said there's a sadness to my work. To some extent, that might be true, but I feel it's more a recognition and respect for the lives of those whose livelihoods have waned under the relentless pressure of development. As our marine heritage slowly fades due to the forces of progress, I see my work as a way to preserve what used to be, and for those who remember fondly, and for those who may not know what life was like only a few short decades ago. Since 1989, my home has been in Lewis, Delaware's oldest town. Lewis was settled by the Dutch in the 1630s. It is now a small resort town where the Delaware River and the Atlantic Ocean meet. But until the mid-1960s, Lewis was, for almost a century, a major fishing port for the Menhaden Fleet. Lewis is still truly a small town. Everybody knows everybody. My home and studio are in a house built in 1820. It was moved twice before ending up in town. Today, estuaries and coastal marshes surround the area, bordered on the east by Cape Henlopen State Park, and to the north by the Prime Hook and Bombay Hook wildlife refuges. There is natural beauty in every direction. It's an inspiring place to live and work. When I was 18, I had to decide whether to go to art school or regular college. My parents had lived through the Depression and World War II, and their view, understandably, was that art as a hobby was fine. But I needed to be able to get a real job, and college was the only way. Fortunately, I was accepted at Franklin and Marshall College in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and graduated in 1967. After college, I spent 4 years in the Air Force, and then worked in store design and advertising production. In 1989, I returned to marine painting and have supported myself that way ever since. I don't approach every painting the same way. Sometimes I paint from pure imagination. Other times, my paintings are composed from scenes I've photographed at different times and places during fieldwork. When I find an appealing subject, as a first step in developing my composition, I photograph it from many angles. Later, I crop and refine the images and tape several of them up over my easel. It's almost always necessary to move elements around to make a more effective composition. Occasionally, I even use my ship models to help visualize how a boat would look from a different angle. Light pencil sketches define the final composition, with occasional erasures and redraws. Although I work in acrylics, I use oil techniques. I like to see paint strokes and texture, and I love the look of canvas. While painting, the work often takes on a life of its own, and although I think I know where it's going, I'm often surprised. Sketching and drafting an image on canvas, underpainting it, anything mechanical, is not difficult for me. It may be time-consuming, but it proceeds apace. I believe the real challenge is working out the composition. That's what makes the difference between a good painting and a great one. I take time picking my subjects. If I have a weak concept, I abandon it, and that can be frustrating because time is my most valuable commodity. When you're self-employed like I am, time is very precious. It's something you can never get back. As an artist, I notice when things aren't right. I may have to move something or change a color or darken it. There are many techniques artists use to reach their goals. I paint on canvas glued to plywood panels, so I can crop an image even after it's painted. I use tight bond glue, which I also use for building ship models. I'll spread the glue on a panel using a taping knife or my hands, and then smooth it out to an even layer to eliminate depressions and bubbles. Once the glue is applied, I drape a piece of canvas on the panel with the tooth running straight with the length of the board. Then I start in the center and spread out to the edges in all directions. If some glue bleeds out, that's okay. It will be cut away. When I'm finished, there's no give at all. When you paint with acrylics like I do, you may start with a big blob of paint that you smear on canvas, but the next day you come back and it is flattened right out, since acrylic paints are mostly water. With oil, the paint doesn't shrink very much, and the color doesn't shift. But with acrylic, when it's wet, it's lighter, and when it dries, the medium becomes clearer, and the color darkens a bit. So if you have to repair or touch up, you have to back calculate what the color will be, and that's complicated. I find it's better to overpaint my lines a bit than to have to come back and patch in, because then I don't have to contend with the color shifts. The color I mixed into the sky is not immediately apparent now. There's not a lot of it, that's the truth, but you'll see more of it when the paint dries. Acrylics are also slightly translucent, no matter what the tube says. You would have to paint an eighth of an inch thick layer to get it to be truly opaque. It helps to add a little bit of titanium, even with the darkest colors, to make them more opaque. If I am painting something black, while I do have black acrylic paint in a tube, I rarely use it. Instead, I mix burnt umber and ultramarine blue, and that way I can push the color either way, warm or cool. Mixing up what will be a very dark brown, and I'm using ultramarine and burnt umber. Now the burnt umber is fairly opaque, but the ultramarine is not, and so I want this to be fairly thick and solid, and so I'm mixing up probably a fairly strong mixture of the burnt umber, and I'm going to put just a tiny little bit of white in it. This is a technique most artists use to increase the opacity of the paint. There are two types of black paint. Ivory black, made from carbonized bone, and Mars black, made from iron-based compounds. Ivory black is cooler because it moves toward the bluer tones when white is added to it, whereas Mars black is warmer. It moves towards the redder tones. My palette has evolved over time. I'm now using all the earth colors, burnt sienna, burnt umber, and raw umber, in both solid and transparent versions. For skies, I use three different blues, depending on the look I want to convey. For midday skies, I use ultramarine blue. For late day sky, when it warms up, I use Prussian blue. And I use phthalo blue for morning and evening skies. For plant life, I use sap green because it looks natural. And for reds, I use transparent burnt sienna and occasionally cadmium, which I usually tone up or down with titanium or other colors to control its strength. I also use cadmium yellow, yellow ochre, magenta, and a color called golden ochre, which is a middle range yellowish brown, but quite bright on a painting. My compositions keep me interested in my work, and while I am not above taking commissions, they sometimes involve painting things I might not want to paint. Nevertheless, I would tell a young artist starting out, it benefits you to do commissions.
Whenever you're doing a composition, you want to make sure that important parts of what you're drawing don't end at or behind a post or something like that. So, you know, in the drawing here, there's a post right at the very end of the hall. Well, I don't want it there. I want it to be here so that I can show the end of the hall. And I'm probably going to have to make sure I spot if there's any other places where that happens, you know, to keep it, you know, to kind of follow the rule here. It's like, for example, here, you would not let a, this is a part of a bulkhead, you wouldn't let the bulkhead just end right at the top of the island across the creek. You know, so you would bring these up a little bit or keep them down below. For the same reason, you know, when you're drawing one in the distance, you don't want it to be exactly right there. You want to overlap it a little bit. And whenever you're drawing structure in a marine environment, nothing is straight. Everything leans or is out of kilter one way or another. So anytime you see a painting or a drawing of a marine, a waterfront, or a scene like this, you know, trust me, everything in it leans one way or the other.
It's great if you can be an artist that doesn't need anybody, where the only person you have to please is yourself. But that's not the world I live in. I have to take commissions to make a living, and I'm pleased when people like my work enough to give me a commission. It's a compliment. But the subject may not always be something I favor. And I tell clients they want to buy a painting from me, it's better to buy something I've already painted, because that's something I loved painting. And I think that shows up in the work. With commissions, while I always do the best I can for the client, it's not the same as painting a subject I've chosen. What I normally do with commissions is take a third of the fee up front and then the rest when I deliver it. That way, I get a nice check upon completion, and that maintains my motivation. I know how fortunate I am to make my living doing something that I like, that I'm good at, and that people are willing to pay for.
Okay, I have enough of a drawing now to work from, and the next step is going to be to spray it with a workable fixative so that will preserve my drawing and I'll be able to paint right over it without any danger of losing the drawing. And the reason you have to think about that is if you watch, you know, oh, it's gone. So that's why I put a fixative on it.
I don't wake up every day with a desire to paint. I might go to a photo shoot or build a ship model, which I've done for over 50 years. Field shoots and building boat models are like a palate cleanser for me. While I may not touch the brush every day, I'm pretty intense during my busy season. For example, about 2 months before the annual Waterfowl Festival in Easton, Maryland, I do a painting a week. I paint 10 hours a day, 7 days a week, with no time off. Since I work in acrylics, I do one painting at a time. Oil painters often work on several paintings at a time, but with acrylics, which dry quickly, I don't have to.
So the next step is going to be putting the tone all over it, under painting. I'm going to cover the whole canvas with a light brown color to build on, and the way I do it is I mix, this is a transparent raw umber, and this is matte medium and water. And if you thin this out too much, you'll have the problem of it'll bead up and it won't really stick to the surface. So that's why I add the matte medium. Then you don't have to do everything with a brush. This is just a pad, and I've put some paper inside it. I learned a long time ago you can't just use the paper because it'll shred and leave pieces on the canvas. So I just make up a thing like this, I wet it, and then the next step is I loosely spray the piece.
Since acrylics dry so fast, I've developed techniques for dealing with time issues when I paint. So to keep the paint workable, sometimes I spray the canvas with a mist of water to slow down the drying.
This just brings the canvas down to like the average value of the painting. Okay, so the canvas is dry enough to work on. So the next thing I'm going to do is do a preliminary sketch of the way I want this to look. And as you can see, I still have my drawing because I sealed it under the workable fixative. And so what I'm going to use is a mix of burnt umber, ultramarine, and raw sienna. And I'll mix them in various ways to get the tone that I want. Now you might notice that in the painting, and even in the finished painting, the boat's going to be a lighter color, but what I will do is I will build that up over top of this, and the paint will be broken in several places, which will allow the darker values to shine through. Thank you. See, all I'm really doing here is reinforcing my original sketch. But the more paint I get on here that shows me where that is, the less likelihood I'll lose the original idea for the composition. Although, I can almost guarantee you that I will end up making some changes here before I finish this. Most of the colors in acrylics are essentially, no matter what they say, they're transparent or at best translucent. So you have to go over them quite a few times to get a real dark, clear, opaque color. So that's why you may have noticed that I just draw right over things that, you know, that will cross each other at a later point. Okay, this is the point where I would stop and let the painting rest for a little bit. Just added some matte medium to the mixture to bring the color down a little more. I have one of the benefits of, you know, transparency with this stuff that makes it easier to, you know, see what you're doing and make changes and corrections and add a great deal of depth. Okay. As I've looked at this after I did the last brush strokes, I sort of felt that this piece that I had put in here was too massive and directed your eye away from the boat. So what I'm going to do is change that and turn it more so that it gives you a little bit of a direction towards this boat. This is one of the beauties of acrylics, is this has dried and now I can draw on it with a white pencil and see my lines. Okay, and here. One, two, three, four. I won't let that one go all the way across. Okay. I made this paint a little darker so this would stand out a little more. Okay, I think that makes a more interesting composition. So what I'm going to do now is put in the lighter colors of the sky and the water, and you may have noticed there's a couple little puddles here that add realism to the scene. Okay, I'm going to take the color down a little bit for the water. So I just put the burnt sienna in. Now I'm going to put a little bit of the green in. And they balance each other, or react against each other, however you want to describe it. So now the water's just a tiny bit darker. Okay, the next thing I want to do is put in some middle tones and start to really build this painting. Okay, I've added some more burnt umber because I've pretty much burned up what I used there, and I've added a paint color called golden ochre that I like. It's very strong. It's hard to explain. It just has a lot of impact, and it's also very opaque, so I like that. So I'm going to start mixing my middle tones here, and that's kind of what we're talking about, and add a little white. Again, notice I'm working with a lot of paint here. If I want to take this down a little bit, make it a little darker, I just put in a little bit of blue. See, and it takes it to a gray. Okay. And this is for me a middle tone. Now, this is the middle of the process also.
Over time, as artists' interests change, so does their subject matter. In my case, I've maintained similar interests for many years, but I think I've gotten more skilled. Of the artists who have come before me, there are many I admire, including Turner, Monet, Winslow Homer, all three Wyeths, Edward Hopper, and a group of Impressionists known as the Kaskob School, named for a town in Connecticut just north of Greenwich. I had an epiphany with Hopper's work on a visit to the National Gallery in Washington. As I went through the exhibit, I got to see his work with my own eyes, and it had so much life I hadn't recognized before. It made me realize that you cannot translate a painting into a four-color image in a book. It just doesn't work. I discovered that just like some people have charisma, paintings do also. Hopper's work has a straightforward composition, good solid colors, and solid brushwork. A lot of them are of Maine, in places I've been many times, and that appeals to me on a personal level. N.C. Wyeth's work is full of imagination, especially his paintings of The Last of the Mohicans. Andrew Wyeth's work is different from his father's. Andy did the Helga portraits and scenes of Chester County where I grew up, so I'm familiar with many sites he portrays in his paintings. As for Jamie Wyeth, he is also quite a visionary like his grandfather, and he's every bit as good an artist as his father and granddad.
I don't want to lose any of these colors that I've mixed, so I'm going to scrape them up and put them on the side here. I mean, I remember my formulas pretty well for the things that I mix up, but still, this way it's right there and I don't have to remix it. Okay, now I'm going to add a little transparent burnt sienna. This will give me the reds and the rust colors that I'm looking for on the hull of the boat. Okay, so at this point, I've got most of my middle values in. I'm starting to cut in my detail, and probably at this point, I would stop and let the painting rest. There's still some areas that I want to finish and put in details, like for example, here, you know, I want to show the reflection of this particular post, and there's some other areas where you're clearly going to have a reflection in the waters, these little puddles. Remember, this thing is at a slight angle, so the reflection will be like that. This is another advantage of painting in acrylics, because you can draw right over it with a pencil and at a later point just come back and erase it. Another thing I want to make absolutely certain of is that my reflection is the same size as the original. So I'm using these calipers here. So see that? My reflection will stop there. And this one will be there. And I don't think this one will reach that other little puddle. Oh, okay, it will. All right, now I found out where all my reflections are going to be. I got out my mile stick because I realized that I'd put the heel of my hand in some of the wet paint, so I get it out here and keep my hand off of the thing I just painted. You don't have to use these a lot with acrylics. Usually with a little bit of forethought, you can work from top to bottom or left to right and not end up putting your hand on top of something you just painted. But every once in a while, the way you're doing something just creates the problem. I found a lot of time when you're trying to paint behind something on a painting, if you stop at the object and then try to continue on the other side, it doesn't look natural. So I think the best way to handle something like that is just to paint right through it like it's not there and then come back and remove anything you've painted over it. I've always had a little bit of a challenge trying to make credible ship's lines. Decided to use a stick and a string. This is another thing that works equally well for drawing, you know, shorter lines. These very thin brushes with the long brush part work very well. I think I'm going to add a product that they call Flow Aid to this. You don't want to be using a lot of this. All right, that should help the paint flow out of the brush better. Now these lines, I probably should paint them dark here and then lighten them up a little bit when they come here because otherwise, you get in this area here and you won't be able to see them at all. The faster you do this, the more mistakes you make. So I have tried to force myself to slow down and just take my time. Okay, so the next step that I go through with a painting is I'm going to glaze it. And what I'm basically doing is adding a layer of detail. The glazing will darken this down a little bit and at a later point enable me to come put lighter colors to bring up the subjects. But the other thing that glazing does is it adds, you know, irregular color and light and dark and stuff like that, which just makes it more interesting. So this is my palette that I'm using for the glazing. And primarily I use, although they tell you not to do this, I use matte medium, but I do add a little bit of retarder that slows it down. and my colors here, I do have burnt umber and ultramarine that if I really want to get a black, I have that. I've got my ultramarine, my burnt sienna, and my raw sienna, and you can see I pretty much have red, blue, and yellow. And with these three colors, you can come up with almost any brown or rust color you want. Surprisingly, a blue, this is the ultramarine. Now this is transparent color. And red, the raw sienna mixed together to make a beautiful brown. And there it is. And if you want to warm it up with a little yellow, you just add that in. And you just can make some great colors this way, just by mixing these together. So there, that's where we're going to start. I'm going to add a little more red to this, red it up a little bit. Okay. Being careful not to glaze the color of the reflected water. Now you may be wondering if I'm changing the color here, but this is a good place to see the difference. I'm looking closely to make sure I didn't miss any particular places that I wanted to glaze down. This particular step just takes the painting down and darkens it. And what I'll do next is start to build all the details. You know, I'll put graining on the pilings here. I'll probably add a seam or two to the boat, maybe a little more rust here, a little more color there. And on this particular piece of upside down deck, I'll probably start to just finish off the colors and the definitions of the ribs. And I'll probably put some grain on these pieces here. And this just gives me a base to start from. Okay, so I've worked a bit on this since we looked at it last, and I've made a lot of decisions. I had had a little area of water here, and I had done the reflections of these boards from the bulkhead, and it didn't look right. So I just took it out and painted over it and restored the finish that I wanted to have here. Now, I would think you also notice that this area here has been detailed, and you know there's several layers of painting work here that may not be immediately apparent. So the first thing that I did was I painted in a lighter color. I had glazed the whole area down dark again, and then I came back in and started to lighten it up. Now, the effect of all of that is just to give it more depth and detail and interest. I did a lot of detailing, scumbling and dry brush and just fine lines and did, you know, detail work on the wood so that now it looks like old weathered wood. I've done a little bit of detail work on the boat. I have to get up and step back and look at the painting from a distance. And you often will see little things that can be improved. ¶¶ One of the hardest things for an artist to do is to decide when the painting is finished. Should I add some clouds to the sky and darken it down a little bit at the top? Painting is done. I varnish it with gloss medium applied with a brush. I lay the painting flat on a table and spray it lightly with water. Then I squirt on gloss medium and brush it out. The water gives me time to coat the entire surface. Keeping it flat lets it dry without brush marks. If a month later I see something I don't like, I can paint over it. And that's an advantage spirit-based varnish does not allow. From a marketing perspective, I'm always thinking about how to present my work at a show. One key strategy I follow is to feature a premier piece, usually a big painting designed to get buyers to say, "Wow." I design my premier piece to demonstrate my best work, and I advise young artists putting up a show to do the same. Another strategy I advise young artists is to feature pieces that are your bread and butter. Not everything can be $3,000. You have to have some $395 pieces so that buyers can afford to start collecting your work. I sit on the Planning Commission for the City of Lewis. I served on the Lewis Historic Preservation Commission for 6 years. I am a trustee for the Rehoboth Art League and a board member of ARTCO, a state arts funding entity. I have always enjoyed volunteer work for a number of local nonprofits. I recommend it highly. It is very satisfying. We as artists do not exist in a vacuum. We are part of a community. Frankly, we are usually needed, and volunteer work is immensely rewarding.